Tommy.
What's up, guys? Guys, we have such a great show. Thank you for being here. Hey, Charlotte, what's up on Instagram? I am live on Instagram on Conciencias Con Cocktail, and I'm also here making this fabulous drink for today, which is going to be so delicious. We are making the pudding. That's right. The President of the United States Punch. Okay, can you believe it? I found it. I cannot believe that I actually found this beverage, and it's perfect for today because we are going to have Christina, Carrica, and Kenneth Romero on today, and we are going to be examining all of the political news for this month. So I cannot wait, because you know guys, there's a lot I'm going to talk about. I mean, Democratic Convention, Republican Convention. I mean, there's so many things happen on those conventions that we got to talk about. So I'm going to start with our beverage of today. Again, the CO3 Punch. We are going to stir today. We're not going to shake or anything. We are going to stir. So we're going to start by putting a few cubes of ice into our mixing pot. Here we go. You're going to get vodka, your favorite vodka. Today we're using Tito's vodka, but you can use Brangus, you can use Vesta, you can use Reka vodka, if you like Iceland vodka. And then we're going to do fresh lime juice, we're going to do orange juice, we're going to do grenadine, and some simple syrup, some fresh blackberries, and that is going to be of the best. So, let's start. All right. First, put some ice in there. You're going to start with your least expensive ingredient, just in case you have to remake your drink, then you're not wasting valuable liquor. You see what I mean? So we're gonna start with 1 ounce of lime juice. All right, then we're gonna do 1 ounce of grenadine. And these are so cute. You can just find these at the liquor store. You don't have to buy like some big quantity. This is for us to have fun, not to get toe up. Okay. So 1 ounce of grenadine. We have 1 ounce of OJ as well. So far we have 1 ounce of lime, 1 ounce of orange juice, 1 ounce of grenadine. Here we go. Then we're going to do 1/2 ounce of simple, which I already have pre-poured. And then we're gonna add your 2 ounces of vodka, all right? Make sure you fill it to the top. And what you're going to do is that you're going to take 4, 5, 6 fresh berries in there. Now, you can either muddle them at the top of the drink, or you can just right now just go in there really lightly and just muddle your blackberry. Easy breezy. Look at that. Isn't that already looking like super delicious? So again, you can muddle at the top or you can muddle at the bottom, up to you. I like to muddle at the once everything is in there. So you can grab all that flavor. Then we're gonna go ahead and stir. Use your bar spoon and just start stirring. And what you want to do is you want to kind of get rid of that ice. So that's why you only put like 3 ice cubes or so. Make sure that you have a glass with ice waiting for you. And you're going to stir that for like 20 seconds, 30 seconds. Make sure it's nice and cold. And since we want all that blackberry in there, we don't have to fine strain it. We don't have to strain it at all. We're just going to go ahead and pour it in there. You want to taste it? Oh my God, delicious. And then you just pour it. Delicious. And then we're going to go ahead and garnish with some fresh blackberry. The president of the United States punch, you guys. It is delicious. It's going to even be even more delicious in November when Biden and Harris win. You know what I'm saying? We're going to have a lot of these then. Here's hoping, y'all. But again, we're going to talk a whole lot about what's happening with political news today with Christina Haley and with Kenneth Romero. And this is delicious. It's the perfect look. It's August 27th. I know summer's about to be like pizza. So right now, this is perfection. Oh my God, it's so good. Listen, so Tito's vodka, Grey Goose vodka, whatever vodka you like. You're going to do 2 ounces of that. You're going to do 1 ounce of grenadine, 1 ounce of lime juice, 2 ounces, an ounce of orange juice, and 1/2 ounce of simple syrup, and your fresh blackberries, and you are set. All right, guys, so listen, it's 30 minutes. Go to my bio, go to soliberty.com, go to Facebook, go to YouTube Live, on on Soul Liberty's magazine. YouTube channel and so Twitter, we're all there too if you prefer that. So we're gonna go ahead and get ready and see you guys in 30 minutes, and we cannot wait again. And we have Jhesus Aponte on our CO3 Lounge today. He's gonna give us some Latin fusion and some juicy cues and all that. It's delicious. So I can't wait for you guys to get to see him. And again, just welcome the Carrica and Romero segment, which is our first one tonight. So we cannot wait. We're so excited. All right, guys. Me voy. Salud. I hope you guys enjoy it. I'm definitely going to be making more of this. It's delicious. All right, guys. Besitos, and I'll see you in like 30 minutes. All right. Peace. You guys, what is going on? Buenas noches, mi gente. Good evening, my people, and welcome back to Conciencias Con Cocktails with me, Javier Pedroza. Again, thank you guys, everyone, for tuning in today and every Thursday at 6 p.m. on Soliberty.com, Soliberty Latinx, also on Soliberty's magazine channel on YouTube, Facebook Live, and Twitter. If you're watching on Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube Live, comment. And if you have any questions during our show, please let us know and we will try to answer them for you. And also actually be sure to follow us on IG, Conciencias Con Cocktails. Listen, guys, today I am so excited because we have such a great show. You know, before we get to our show, I hope everybody had a productive and beautiful weekend because I know it's been quite the week.
And I just hope that you are all safe. You know, you all continue to be safe. Your family, your friends, everyone around you continue to be safe. Community. It's all about community, right? So excited to get the conversation started this week because we have three of my favorite people on today. But you know what? Before we get to this week, I'd like to thank last week's guests. Last week's guest, we had the pleasure of having Dr. Fran Melendez. And we had such a great conversation and discussion about mental health, COVID, going back to school. I mean, we talked so much that families reached out saying thank you because, you know, these times are so uncertain that you don't know what to do. And she was really able to, you know, as a professional, as a doctor, as a mental health professional, she was able to, you know, give us some pointers that we can apply to our everyday life. So that was really amazing. And we danced our heart outs with Tiago Raul, who is such a great actor, singer, dancer, choreographer, de Puerto Rico también. He's such a great guy. And again, we had a blast. So again, thank you both for being with us. And I can't wait to see you both again. On today's show, we have a segment that I've been dying to get to, and that is the Carrica and Romero segment, which is going to be every last Thursday of every month. And, you know, we're going to examine the political news of the month with Christina Carrica Haley and Mr. Kenneth Romero. So we cannot wait for you. Listen, if you didn't catch Christina and Kenneth on our show, a little background about these two amazing folks. Christina, I always call her the Latina powerhouse because that's exactly who she is. And, you know, I can't wait for one day for her to start running the world because that is what we see happening with Christina. But today, Christina serves as a senior policy advisor at Aiken Group. And she sits on the board of the Latino Victory Project. So we can't wait to talk to Christina because I know she's been traveling and this election is keeping her very busy. Also, we have Mr. Kenneth Romero, as I mentioned, and he's the executive director at the National Hispanic Caucus of State Legislators. And, you know, he also happens to be one of the coolest Boricuas that I have the honor to know and to call my friend. He is extremely, extremely knowledgeable. He's super intelligent, not cocky, which we love. He is always there to give you a hand. If I have any questions, what has to do with anything that he knows, which is pretty much everything, all I have to do is call Kenneth and he gives you the answer straight up as we like it. So we can't wait for Kenneth to join us. We also have Jhesus Aponte, a two-time world salsa champion with us at our CO3 Lounge, where we celebrate the arts, culture, dance, fashion, and music. So Cannot wait for you guys to see Mr. Jhesus because he's one of my inspirations as a dancer growing up. So can't wait to share him with all of you, for those of you who don't know him, although a lot of you do know who he is. Our fourth guest is our signature cocktail. And I got to tell you guys, this is like the perfect drink, which is the POTUS, which is the President of the United States. And look at that, blackberries, yep, not raspberries, not strawberries, blackberries, and it is delicious. This, obviously, the drink is to complement our show today because we have, again, Carrica and Romero here, and we're going to discussing politics. So listen, salud, let me take a sip because you know it's rude. Oh my God, this is the best punch, guys. And I'm telling you, as a friend said, I can have this cocktail for the next 4 to 8 years. So hint, hint, right? But listen, again, this delicious punch is made with vodka, 2 ounces of vodka. You can use Tito's, Grey Goose, vodka. I mean, there's so many Reka vodka. There's so many great, delicious vodkas out there. Also, we have 1 ounce of fresh lemon juice, 1 ounce of orange juice, 1 ounce of grenadine, half an ounce of simple syrup, 4 to 6 blackberries, fresh blackberries for your garnish also. And all you have to do is in a mixing glass, you muddle the berries, you add the ice, add the ingredients, you stir, pour over ice, and you drink, and then you go vote, okay, in that order, all right? So just make sure to start getting in your head, because we have to vote. I mean, everyone, I know that for some of us out there, voting for the first time, you know, please exercise your right to vote. Whoever your vote is, that is your business completely, and I don't want to know who you're voting for either. But listen, we have 67 days for the 2020 U.S. presidential election, and at this time, it is the best time to do some research, educate yourselves with this country's history, because one thing that I'm learning day in and day out is that everything is neutral, and it just depends on your experiences in life, where your and your knowledge, where your ideas come from, where you everything that you're thinking. So I really say just research. You know, to quote the beautiful Miss Pima Chandrone, she says, and I quote, "Fear is a natural reaction to moving closer to the truth." All right. So again, with that, I'm going to say salute to you guys. Mm-mm-mm. It is so good. I feel like I'm going to be saying salute a whole bunch of times on this show. But listen, I am so excited now, because now we're going into our spotlight stories, where we highlight our current events and trending news. So today we're going to start our spotlight series with Hurricane Laura hitting Louisiana overnight. So sad, because, you know, these winds of 150 miles per hour causing power outages for more than 300,000 people, you know, and it's almost 15 years exactly to Hurricane Katrina. So take a look.
Overnight, Hurricane Laura slamming ashore as a monster Category 4, punishing the Louisiana and Texas coast with winds up to 150 miles an hour. But even more dangerous, especially in low-lying areas, a massive storm surge that officials are warning could be unsurvivable.
That storm surge could continue inland for about 30 miles.
The powerful hurricane packing high winds and driving rain, wrecking buildings and toppling trees.
As quickly as those winds picked up, they've died down just as fast. We are in at least part of Laura's eye right now, a few minutes of peace before we catch the backside of that storm.
Why would you stay in harm's way?
On Wednesday, with Laura gaining strength in the Gulf, most coastal residents heeded warnings. At least 500,000 people ordered to evacuate, boarding up, packing up, and heading to safety.
We'll replace everything else. Yeah. You can't replace your life.
Even some who had planned to stay making 11th hour decisions to get out.
We was gonna stay, but when they said Category 4, that was it.
Others determined to ride it out in Texas.
When you've lived on the island most of your life, and all your life, you're going to weather storms. We're going to weather it out, see how it goes.
And Louisiana.
We're just staying. We got a generator. We stocked up on plenty of food, so we don't plan on leaving.
Many still concerned about going to shelters and the looming dangers of the coronavirus. This morning, Louisiana's National Guard is staged and ready to roll, assessing the damage left behind and starting search and rescue operations for those who couldn't or wouldn't leave.
Of course, one of the big questions right now, how many people were affected by this storm when it roared ashore? We know that in the Cameron Parish, 150 people chose to stay behind, and they did not evacuate as officials urged them to do so. That area, we're told, could have faced a storm surge from Hurricane Laura up to 20 feet high. Rescuers have to wait until this storm dies down before they can even get in and start looking for people to stay.
We are praying for all of those affected, and we hope everyone receives the assistance they desperately need. Our next story on Spotlight is An incredibly disturbing one, to say the least. A black man by the name of Jacob Blake was hospitalized in serious condition after police shot him several times in the back in broad daylight as he opened the door of a parked vehicle in Kenosha, Wisconsin, which is between Milwaukee and Chicago. And I want to let you all know ahead of time, it is a tough video to watch. Here's the latest news.
The latest on the police shooting of Jacob Blake. Authorities now revealing the identity of the officer who shot the 29-year-old father in the back. Alex Perez is there with the very latest. And Alex, another night of protests.
Yeah, good morning, Cecilia. After three nights of violent and deadly protests, additional National Guardsmen were called in, and things were peaceful here overnight. Now, authorities this morning are telling us more about the officer who shot Jacob Blake. Authorities identifying the Kenosha officer seen in videos shooting Jacob Blake seven times in the back as Rustin Shesky. Authorities say he's a seven-year veteran of the force. Investigators say before the shooting, Blake admitted to officers he had a knife. That knife was found on the floor inside of his vehicle. Now, separately, authorities have arrested 17-year-old Kyle Rittenhouse from neighboring Illinois on charges of first-degree murder in connection with shootings Tuesday night that left two people dead and one injured. Authorities confirmed Rittenhouse was armed with a long gun and captured on videos saying he had come to the area to protect property. Now, Shesky and the two other officers who responded to that call are on administrative leave pending outcome of this investigation.
We will definitely keep following this story and continue reporting as the information becomes available. Our third story is actually an inspiring one, which makes me happy. But you know what? The games will not go on. Professionally, athletes are taking part in an incredible collective action in support of the Black Lives Matter movement and against police violence, bringing basketball, baseball, and soccer leagues to a grinding halt. Take a look at Miss Amy Goodman on Democracy Now!
This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman. In a remarkable development Wednesday, professional basketball, baseball, soccer games came to an unprecedented halt after Milwaukee Bucks players refused to take to the court for a playoff game against the Orlando Magic in support of Black Lives Matter. The NBA then canceled all three of Wednesday's playoff games. Then, on TNT, former basketball star, the sports commentator Kenny Smith, walked off the set of Inside the NBA in solidarity with the protesters.
As a black man, as a former player, I think it's best for me to support the players and just not be here tonight. And figure out what happens after that. Yeah, I just don't feel equipped to do that.
And I respect that.
You then can't hear him much because he's taken off his microphone and he walks off the TV set. The women's WNBA also canceled three games Wednesday after members of the Washington Mystics arrived wearing T-shirts, each with seven holes symbolizing the seven bullet holes in the back of their T-shirts, with the fronts of the T-shirts spelling out the name Jacob Black. Each woman wearing Jacob Blake. Each woman wearing a T-shirt with one of the letters of Jacob Blake's name. This is Mystics guard Ariel Atkins.
This isn't just about basketball. We aren't just basketball players. And just because we are basketball players doesn't mean that's our only platform. We need to understand that when most of us go home, we still are black.
Three Major League Baseball games were postponed after players on the Milwaukee Brewers, Seattle Mariners, and other teams joined protests. Mets slugger Dominic Smith kneeled for the national anthem ahead of Wednesday night's game against the Florida Marlins and broke down in tears at a post-game press conference. Most of Wednesday's Major League Soccer games were postponed in the Western and Southern Open tennis tournament suspended matches after tennis superstar Naomi Osaka, whose father is Haitian, withdrew to protest against racial injustice.
Thank you to all of the sports league for using your platforms and taking a stand against Black Lives Matter and police brutality. We're just hoping this stops very soon. As someone who covers these stories, I have to say that it's really, really difficult, and I can only imagine what the communities of color feel day in and day out, specifically Black people, right? And the Afro experience, the indigenous experiences in this country. So guys, that wraps up Spotlight today. And I am now going to be introducing our fears, two people that just make my heart smile. And I'm so happy because again, with these news, you just kind of need some great vibes to come your way. And you know, people to share just their beautiful, beautiful energy. And again, these two are amazing. I mean, you're going to get to know them, like I said, every last Thursday of the month, because they're going to be here with us just breaking the political news down. With that said, I want to say welcome to Christina Carrica Haley and Kenneth Romero.
Hola.
How are you guys?
Doing well. How about yourself? Got to see Javier.
I'm great, Kenneth. How are you? Oh my God, it's been so long. Christina, mi amor, ¿cómo estás?
How are you? I'm so good. A little bit drained after this week, understandably. So, well, after these several weeks, but, you know, excited to be here. So excited, Kenneth, for us to finally start doing this and kind of can't wait to dive in. It's been 2 weeks of amazingness and then awfulness when we get to the RNC, but just my opinion.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thank you guys again for being with us. I really appreciate you both taking the time to examine our monthly political news, you know, because a lot of people need a little help, you know, kind of understanding, you know, the climate today. You know, one thing we hear one thing we hear the next. And so I want to, before we get into all of that, I know that you guys have been incredibly busy as we just spoke. And Christina, I know that you have been traveling. You went to London. How was that?
Yes. So I was only in London just to fly in. And then I was out in the countryside doing my quarantining in a cottage. I was originally supposed to be out there doing some work. But of course, with everything going on, understandably so, I was switched to, you know, a virtual platform, but I still got to go out there and it was great. It was really interesting, one, to be there. I was out there during the week of the Democratic Convention. So not only getting a little bit of a break from the United States in the sense of seeing and then really realizing what a tense environment we're in right now. And we've been in for a long time, but right now it's just at the surface. And getting to talk to some folks socially distanced with masks, of course, you know, outside of the country and some expats, friends of mine that are over there that can vote. Just FYI, even if you live in another country, if you're an American citizen, you can vote. So let's make sure that happens. And so kind of getting the take on that. And it was really interesting. And getting to watch the Democratic Convention in Europe and kind of getting their takes on it. And we also did with Latino Victory Project, we actually did an event with President Biden because he is so committed to turning out the Latino community. So it was amazing getting to chat with him a bit and then sharing him as well as Lin-Manuel Miranda, who's very involved with Latino Victory Project, and J-Lo and Eva Longoria, who was one of the co-founders, and all of them really getting involved to get our community going. So that's all to be said. I am happy to be back. The reason I was happy to be back is because there wasn't so much to do, but I am happy to be back to join my brothers and sisters on the street protesting the violence that we've seen, not only in the recent days, but the fact that Breonna Taylor's killers still aren't arrested and all of that fun stuff. So yeah. Great time, but happy to be back and get to work for the next, what was it, 67 days?
67 days. Absolutely. We're so happy that you're back home safely in D.C. So again, thank you for taking the time because I know we talk and I'm like, my goodness, I thought I was busy. So also, I want to kind of talk to me because I know, again, I've been keeping up with you and you have been hosting some great events. You spoke with Dr. Fauci. You were recently mentioned on the Hill newspaper with an incredible quote, which we'll get to. You also did Si Se Vota, the Latino leaders strategizing the battleground states. You guys are busy. Talk to me, Kenneth. How are you?
Well, yes, as you mentioned, very busy, but very happy to be joining you and your audience and the powerhouse that is Christina. So it's really an honor. We've been working very, very hard this summer, starting with an event, as you mentioned, with Dr. Fauci. It was the first time that Dr. Fauci engages directly on a conversation with the Latino community, the first Hispanic organization. He sat down for half an hour to talk about how COVID has had a particular impact on Hispanics and people of color, and also talking about the possibilities of vaccines and what that is going to look like, and particularly in terms of the clinical trials that have to take place to make sure that these vaccines are effective to communities of color and people who have underlying conditions, right? So that was a very important conversation. And then we also had, as you mentioned, the Latino leaders strategizing battleground states. One thing that is very important is in this election for anybody out there that is Hispanic or a person of color, but particularly Hispanics, we need to go out and vote. And so the reason why we had this conversation was there are several states that are considered battleground states, and those happen to be states where the Hispanic community have deep roots and are a large percentage of the eligible voters makeup in those states. And so it's important to understand why, if you live in Arizona or in Florida or in Texas, you need to make sure you vote, that you also understand the ways in which you can vote by mail-in, doing early voting, et cetera, obviously trying to be as safe as possible, but trying to do it as early as possible definitely helps in making sure that we as a community can flex our political muscle and make sure that the people that we elect respond to the needs that we have as a community and will only help to uplift and improve the quality of life of Hispanics in this country.
Absolutely. I could not agree with you more. And you know what? Before we keep diving into political news, we need a sip. What are you guys drinking today?
Well, I actually got a cocktail from a friend of mine that's part of a group here that's called Back to Black. And it's a rum-based cocktail because she's Caribbean. And it's all Black bartenders that are getting together to sell their cocktails and raise money for the Black Lives Matter movement.
I love that. We may have to have them.
I'm jealous of the POTUS.
What about you, Kenneth? What are you drinking over there?
I wish I had a POTUS cocktail like you have. Perhaps next time you can send it over a few days before, and all we have to do is add the vodka, right? But I'm having an IPA beer. It's really hot and humid in Washington, D.C., and it's a time of year that I really can appreciate a great IPA. That's my favorite type style of beer. So cheers.
Salud. Cheers, guys. Salud. Salud to November 2020.
Ojalá.
Oh, my God. Delicious. All right. So DNC, RNC, for those who are still, like, I'm telling you, I want to break it down to like somebody who just turned on the TV. The Democratic National Convention and the Republican National Convention just happened. And first thing first, everything is virtual, right? Obvious for obvious reason. Christina, how do you think voters are connecting to a virtual convention versus a traditional live convention?
Well, you know what? It's really interesting. I've been involved in the past two conventions, one, actually on the team with Hillary Clinton. And it's funny because, you know, my mother, my abuela, a lot of my friends have never watched a convention and they watched this year. Maybe that's because of the horrible man we have in the White House and people are actually trying to invest time to get him out of there. Or maybe it's because it seems more accessible, right? Like, there's a lot of people, I didn't know what a convention was or did or what took place at a convention until I was actually in this career. So I kind of feel like it's a bit antiquated, and maybe that's my, you know, millennialness, or I like to say elder millennial, shining through. But I have seen a lot more people who are usually not politically engaged who would not tune in even for a Michelle Obama speech at an in-person convention, that were watching, that were engaging, and that were starting conversations that needed to be had.
Oh, I love it. I love that, because you're right. There were friends that I speak to, even family, as you mentioned, like, really don't tune in. Like, they're just, you know, and again, you know, politics, we were all kind of under a veil for so long, and now it's come off and we're just like, hold up, we gotta tune in. Kenneth, what are your thoughts on virtual conventions?
Well, I agree with Christina. I think it has to do also with the fact that people realize that the way that this pandemic has had an impact on our community has been in multiple ways, right? So you, no matter where you live here in the United States, you've been impacted either because you or a family member unfortunately has had COVID, you or a family member lost their job, you or a family member didn't have access to the PPP funds for the small business, for the small bodega that was forced to close, or the small coffee shop that was forced to close because of this pandemic. So whether it be on the economic front, on the job front, or healthcare, whether you were getting unemployment benefits and all of a sudden you're no longer receiving them because Congress didn't extend that and the administration wasn't favoring that. But all of those things connect you, that have that special connection between the people who we elect and the consequences of those decisions, right? And so I think that finally, for the first time, people are making the connection. And it also has to do, obviously, with Black Lives Matter and what we've seen, unfortunately, reflected this summer when it comes to the treatment of people of color. And we also see that there's a connection between the people we elect and the way people of color are treated by law enforcement. So I think that that's what makes it so special. And that's why you see more people than ever connecting to the conventions to hear what politicians have to say as they look forward to November.
Absolutely. And you know what? Also, I think the fact that we have a ticket like Joe Biden and Kamala Harris has kind of like woken some people up. Again, to have Kamala Harris as, you know, the first woman of color, Taina, she's from Jamaica, and Indian from India. So, you know, I think that it was right. I am dying to know, what do you think? Let's start with you, Kenneth. What do you think? I mean, Biden stuck to his word and he selected a woman as his running mate. Were you surprised at the selection?
I wasn't. I have to say that I was hoping that he would appoint a Latina first and foremost, because after all this, in this election, there's 32 million eligible Hispanics voters, right? And so there was Governor Michelle Lujan Grisham was consistently being named in that short list by different media sources. She's such a strong, powerful, amazing Latina leader, right? Somebody who has served Congress before being in Congress was actually Secretary of Health. Boy, do we need that type of experience in a position like that, right? And then she went to Congress and now is the governor of New Mexico, right? So, but I have to say that in that regard, Senator Harris certainly checked off all the boxes as well. I mean, somebody who is very experienced, who comes with a, you know, an incredible lifestyle, a life story, I should say, of immigrant parents and being biracial, which is also just enriches her life and also what she will be able to do as vice president. I think when it comes to the Latino community, it's important to know that before the announcement was made that she was the candidate, there were already polls that indicated that Latinos, particularly in battleground states, were very excited and that they were more likely to vote for a Biden-Harris ticket than a Biden-X somebody else ticket. Right. In Texas, for example, 50% of Latinos said that they were more likely to vote if Harris was on that ticket. Same thing in Florida, 47%, Arizona, 54% more likely. And in Pennsylvania, 50% more likely.
50 how much?
53% in Pennsylvania, right. Likely, which is important to note. And I, to my people out there in Pennsylvania listening and watching this, Pennsylvania sadly has the lowest percentage of Hispanic civic engagement when it comes to the Hispanic community and voting. So it has the lowest percentage proportional to the percentage of Hispanics in the state, right? So we need to make sure that people out there in Pennsylvania understand what's at stake for them and that they register to vote and go ahead and vote. And the good thing about that is the likelihood of a Latino ending up voting once they register is very high, right? Once you convince them you got to register to vote, very likely they'll actually follow up and go and vote. So,
oh my God, Pennsylvania, you guys need to vote. Christina, were you shocked with Harris? I mean, you know, we're also talking about a former national security advisor, Susan Rice, who was on that list. What are your thoughts?
Listen, I don't think anybody was shocked, right? And here's the thing. I love me some Susan Rice. I love me some Michelle Lujan Grisham, Governor Grisham. Any of the women that they mentioned, whether it was Amy Klobuchar, Governor Whitmer, several others would have been great, right? However, we learned nothing from this. Well, there's a lot of things I hope we didn't learn from this administration, but the few things we didn't learn was electability, right? And connecting with people. And as much as I love Susan Rice, there's a large population in the United States who has no idea who she is, no matter how great she's done, what she's done for our country and things like that. Kamala Harris has done a great job of making herself a name. Whether you like her or not, you know who she is, right? And at this time, I'm with you, Kenneth. I would have loved to seen a Latina on the ticket. And then I step back for a second too sometimes though, and I realize Black women specifically vote Democratic at a rate of about 99% in any state that you look at. And they are consistently bringing the children to the polls. There's more African-American children that remember going and standing in line and probably getting in trouble because it's so boring, you know, waiting for their mothers to vote and things like that. And so I do think it's very important if we're talking about uniting this country. And that's not to say that any other minority group is not facing, you know, travesties right now. We won't even start with what's going on to the Latino community. But I do think that the way to start that is to bring somebody who is part of that community, who also understands what it's like to be a child of immigrants, who also understands what it's like to be a woman. And in politics, let me tell you, it's not easy. Kenneth, you know this. You know, so having somebody that kind of brings all of these things that we need to bring together anyways, I think it was a great choice. And let's not kid ourselves. The vice president is supposed to prosecute the current president, right? That's their job on the campaign. Joe Biden's a nice guy. He's always going to be a nice guy. So you bring in Kamala Harris, and I don't know if you guys watched her speech today, but she came in with receipts. She came in with examples. Some, you know, slightly veiled going high when he was going low insults to Michelle Obama, but she is prosecuting him. She's a prosecutor and she's ready to go. So I think it was the right choice. And whether or not we have differences about it, that's fine. It'll be better than Trump and Pence.
Absolutely. And I think that's what a lot of us are trying to get that message across. Like, you know, first of all, we have to research her because, you know, a lot of the topic is her record and what she has done and all this and all that. And I'm just like, listen, we're not going to sit here and compare, you know, careers. To me, this is a Black woman who was the first at many, 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 many positions surrounded by white men, right? Well, which people need to think about.
Yeah, and go back. I mean, the double standards that there are for, I mean, let's put Melania Trump and Michelle Obama. It was almost the end of the world when Michelle Obama showed her arms, right? We had, the media went crazy. The first woman's shoulders are out. We have a first lady who posed nude, which again, nothing wrong with that, ladies. If you want to pose nude, if you want to celebrate yourself, do it.
Do you.
But let's not pretend that we are judging Republican and Democratic women on the same scale.
Absolutely.
Black, white, Latina, whatever.
Any of them. So, and speaking of the RNC, right, Kenneth, what do you think the overall message so far, because we have one more night, what do you think the overall message has been? You know, what is the Republicans trying to convey?
I think they're trying to speak very directly to their core base, like really the very core, trying to message that, you know, they want to make America great again, right? Because of the way that, particularly during this pandemic, the way that the economy has tanked, the way that the health aspect of the crisis has been mismanaged when you compare the United States with other countries, et cetera. I think that's what they're trying to message. They're not trying to broaden that base. They're just focusing in that narrow segment of the population, just to make sure that those remain excited, so to speak, about having a second term from President Trump. However, for Hispanics, that's a very difficult message to actually percolate, right? We don't see messaging that is directly targeting Hispanics and how a second term by the president could improve our lives. On the other hand, when you go to the DNC, I mean, just the fact that all of the stellar Hispanic leaders that were showcased, that share their stories, their vision for this country, was just amazing. And I know that there was a little bit of pushback from the Hispanic community because they felt that the DNC didn't really showcase that as much as they wanted. But let me tell you, I mean, you just go through the list of the people that were highlighted throughout the convention, and it's really, you know, kudos to us as a community, right? You had AOC, they had obviously Governor Michelle Lujan Grisham, you had Senator Cortez Masto, they featured several state legislators, very important that when you vote, you're voting also for your local elected officials. So they featured Ivana Cancela, Victoria Niave from Texas. They featured obviously Eva Longoria as the first hostess of, you know, day one of the convention. You had music by Prince Royce. You had Dolores Huerta. You know, our very dear Dolores Huerta was there to speak on behalf of our community. I think the big omission was Secretary Castro. Fortunately, we were able to bring him to that event that we hosted on day one. So he was, in a way, part of the convention as well, right? So.
Yeah, but he was definitely missed, I would say, this year. Like, Julian Castro was missed, in my opinion, for this year. And then AOC being given 60 seconds was quite hysterical. Go ahead, Christina.
Well, hold on. I'm going to step in with a few other opinions on this. Now, I agree with that there are people there. I also agree that Julian Castro is wonderful. But at some point, we don't just need one Latino speaking for our community, right? And so the idea of highlighting new voices, and let me tell you another person who spoke, Congressman Philemon Vela, if we're talking about AOC, we've kind of got AOC on a far more left progressive side of our party. We've got a Michelle Lujan Grisham, who seems is a Democrat, right? She's able to really play with progressives, but she's also tough on certain things that some people see as a more conservative. And then you have somebody like a Philemon Vela, who he's very, very representative of his border, you know, Southern Texas border district that tends to be much more conservative. And so what I loved about the showcasing of the Latinos is that, yes, while some big names like AOC may have only gotten 60 seconds, I would hope that all Latinos wanting state representatives and local folks who are running and all of that to also get on the stage, because we have to build our bench and we have to show that our community is not a monolith. Not one of those members in any spectrum of our party speaks for all of us. And so it was great to me to see that we had obviously throughout, I have to say this, and I love that the Trump convention, because I'm not even calling it the Republican convention, is focusing and focusing and focusing on how far left it is. And in fact, we had some of the most kind of conservative Democratic members that often get in fights with our own members because of their choice on certain votes, right or wrong, whatever you think. And so I have to say that, yes, AOC has done a lot and continues to do a lot for our country, but I do appreciate hearing from a wide variety of voices and making space for new voices from our community to lead.
Like Richie Torres, who's going to be in there next.
I love him. He's so wonderful. Yeah, that's my point. I mean, yes, yeah. AOC is not going anywhere. And that's the thing. She can take 60 seconds and kill it.
And she did.
So yes, well, we'd love to hear more. But hey, she can help others who are also speaking there.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's an absolutely great, great point. So, Kenneth, I have to ask, porque tú eres puertorriqueño, you are Puerto Rican man. I mean, Christina, you could relate because your father is an immigrant.
My mother.
Your mother, excuse me.
Yeah.
Your mother,
yeah. My dad's assimilated into the Latino culture, so I'm sure he'll
one
be
of us. For sure. But Kenneth, I have to get your thoughts on Kimberly Guilfoyle at the RNC. You know, when I quote, you know, as a first generation American and also immigrant comment that she made. Talk to me how you feel about her comments.
That's what's in French they call a big faux pas, right? I mean, how could you describe yourself as having an immigrant history or heritage because your mother comes from Aguadilla, Puerto Rico, right?
Wait, I'll step in really quick before we start talking. She worded it that way, but I will say she is the child of an immigrant. Her father immigrated from Ireland, but
absolutely.
She used it like that. And that's what, because it actually lessens the Irish story of immigrants. Sorry.
Right. But also like to me, and kind of we'll come back. I'm so sorry, because this is so good.
Watch back. I watched the video again after that, just to double check. And she did refer to that in plural. She said both of her immigrants. And so that's why I was so shocked and surprised. And it made me feel like, okay, because I happen to have been born in New York, right? So does that mean that when I moved to Puerto Rico at 4, I immigrated to Puerto Rico?
Just, I don't mean to laugh, but...
Crazy. I mean, it's just crazy because, you know, as you said, she says, my mother, Mercedes, was a special education teacher from Aguadilla, Puerto Rico. My father, also an immigrant, came to this nation to pursue American dream. This is not a dumb woman, okay? Kimberly is an extremely intelligent woman. So to me, this is not a mistake. Do you see what I'm saying? Like, I just, and I always find to, like, find the benefit of the doubt in people. But I mean, she has been, I mean, her life itself.
They this is the thing, right? They try to portray her as a Latina. Like, wow, look, we have Latinas up on stage, on the Republican stage. And so she talks about that, but at the same time, she denies the fact that Puerto Ricans have been American citizens since 1917, right? And that Puerto Ricans, if they move from the island to the mainland, they're not immigrants. It's just like calling somebody that moves from New Jersey to California immigrants, right? Makes no sense. So to me, it was disrespectful and insulting as a Puerto Rican to hear somebody see themselves and think of themselves and want us to think of Puerto Ricans as immigrants.
As second-class citizens, absolutely, which is trying to be the narrative on and on and on and on, right? Is that we don't belong in this country. We shouldn't get the same help as citizens in this country. So what do you think, Christina?
I mean, so the thing is here, it's like you said, it's one, it's disrespectful to Puerto Ricans. It's disrespectful to her father and other immigrants. Because again, it's this whole story painted like as if the only immigrants to the United States are Latino. And it's not true, right? And maybe because there has been a war against the Latino immigrants is why we hear about it all the time. But there are immigrants from other countries from all over the world that struggle to get here, that participate and make this country what it is. So it's disrespectful on that point. And then, like you said, she is intelligent. We can't take that away from her. We can't say the same for the family that she's, you know, dating into, but you know, we can leave that for another.
Right. We'll touch on that in September.
Right. But it's like, you know, you want to shake her and say, why? There are things you can talk about. There are things you can point to, maybe, I mean, that you think this administration has done well, but why fabricate this? Why lie? And it ties into something that they did later in the convention. And I didn't know this. I've been reading about this now. I assumed it, but I didn't say anything when it was going on. But they never told those 5 citizens that were going through the naturalization ceremony that they were going to be part of a political convention. And it just highlights to me the disrespect that they have for anybody. It doesn't matter, immigrant or not. They don't care what you think, what you want, what you need. They're going to use you. You are a resource for them. And not in a positive way. You're a pawn in their game, and that's it. And that's why when they say they care about working people, they care about immigrants, they care about Black people, I'm sorry, let's go beyond the fact that Jacob Blake was shot, and nobody mentions that at the convention, by police. A 17-year-old with an automatic rifle murdered 2 people. And there is nothing said about that. And instead, they react as if he's this good guy that was standing his ground. You can't stand your ground when you drive across state lines to murder people.
Right. And we saw him at Trump's rally as well. Like, he, now the pictures are coming out, like, hardcore Trump supporter, hard club Blue Lives Matter, all of that.
And
so
can I just also say, you can support the cops, but there's nothing like blue. There is no blue life. You have to stop putting career and a race in the same line.
Absolutely. Kenneth, go ahead, Kenneth.
Yeah. I just want to say one more thing about the whole Kimberly incident, and that is, in a way, by denying the fact that Puerto Ricans are U.S. citizens, is in a way trying to justify the mistreatment of Puerto Ricans by this administration after Maria. By saying that Puerto Ricans are immigrants, in people's minds, that, oh, then people that live in Puerto Rico are from a foreign country. So therefore, it wasn't really our responsibility to take care of them after the hurricane, right? So for somebody that doesn't know, then they can justify it in their minds. Like, okay, we did the best we could, but after all, that's not part of the United States, right? And that's why I think it's so offensive to anybody that's Puerto Rican, whether you're from the island or live in the mainland.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Oh my God, guys, I think like we're in the next like September, the last Thursday of September, we're going to need like a 2-hour show. This whole like 1-hour thing is not enough for us. But I want to say thank you so much. Again, you know, guys, we're going to see, we'll be in touch. We're going again, we're going to see them, guys, the last Thursday of September for Carrica and Romero. And again, guys, thank you so much, because again, as I said, you know, you guys are so, so, so busy. So the fact that you guys take the time to, you know, take a little bit out of your day to educate and to just be with our guests and let them know. For you guys, since we're running out of time, make sure you grab the Hill newspaper, because Kenneth was quoted in there, and I hate that we can't get to it because we have like no time, but he basically says that Latinos are more likely to be swing voters than African Americans, and that is what makes us the crown jewel in this election. So go read it, The Hill, and then we're going to come back next month again with Christina and Kenneth. Mua, mi amores, gracias so much.
Gracias.
Thank you for being with me.
It's a pleasure. Love you guys.
Love you. And I can't wait for all of us to be in the same room, social distancing. And I will make the cocktails.
Yes.
I will make the cocktails.
Next time, you know what we're going to talk about? We're going to talk about who's going to get to fill that vacancy when Senator Harris, if she gets elected, right?
Alex Padilla. That's just, sorry.
We already have some names.
Hashtag pick Padilla. It is a majority Latino state. California needs a Latino to run it. I love that you brought it up, Kenneth.
That is right. Oh my God. Thank you guys so, so, so much. Again, I'll see you at the end of the show, because I want you guys to stick around. We're going to go to our CO3 Lounge, and we're going to hang out with our friend Jhesus, who I was able to catch up with him earlier this week, because again, another busy soul who is doing his thing, 2-time salsa world champion, but he's also a Latin fusion choreographer. He is an actor. He is everything. So right now we're going to go to commercial, and we're going to show you a little bit of what Jhesus is working on, and then we'll be right back.
Ask for Candy is partnering with Celebrity Magazine, which means we're back live on Facebook, YouTube, and maybe even Instagram, wherever you get your video podcasts. Join us every Wednesday night live at 7 o'clock for some juicy conversations.
Have you ever asked the question, if I was to be anything, what would I be? Regardless of money.
Coming up next, it's time for our CO3 Lounge. All right, welcome back to CO3 Lounge. Here's where we get to hang out. You get to let your hair down. You get to chill. You get to have a little bit more of your cocktail. It is what it is, you know what I'm saying? So listen, right now we are so again, guys, do we not love Kenneth and Christina? Like, do we not want them to be our friends like forever and ever? Like, I'm so blessed to have them as my friends and, you know, just like people who inspire me. And that's exactly what we should all do. We should all surround ourselves with these beautiful energies that are able to teach us, that we're able to teach them, and we're all learning and growing together. So again, gracias, my gorgeous people. I love you. So now we're going to turn to Jesus. And again, this man is so busy that I was like, listen, I'm gonna record you. And I am going to bring you on Conciencias because people need to know what you do, what you're doing, and learn some steps. So you're going to see some Latin fusion movement happening right now on CO3 Lounge. So again, Jhesus is someone who has inspired me as a dancer since forever. Since I started dancing, I saw him and I was like, who is this man? And I am so happy to provide a platform for someone like him. You know, again, COVID has happened. Virtual classes are now happening more so than, you know, physical in-person classes. So I want to give the platform to these amazing folks who have inspired me, who continue to give back to the community, continue to protect our heritage, our music, our dances. You know, it's being Latino is everything. I mean, it is what it is. I don't know what to tell you. Didn't Michelle Obama say that? It is what it is. Anyway, we love Michelle. Besitos. So listen, right now, get ready to dance, and I'll see you after Jhesus teaches you some, you know, Latin fusion. I'm going to refill my cocktail. So yo, huepa, dance, and I'll be right back.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Conciencias with Cocktail, Con Cocktail. Gracias, muchas gracias por tenerme. Thanks for invitation, for having me today. Amid all these things that are going on, we need to dance. We need to keep ourselves with a good energy and positive energy. So that's why I'm here. So I hope you guys enjoy what I'm going to do. You know, a little bit of something so you could keep, you know, the energy flowing at home or at work, wherever you're, or from the car, wherever you are watching and supporting Javier and all the crew from Conciencias Con Cocktail, CO3, which is I'm loving it so much. Where's my cocktail? So my cocktail is right here, water. So we don't have much time, but we have a good time. We're gonna have a good time. So look what I'm gonna teach you. So we're gonna do crossover side break. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. From there, we're gonna go. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. Okay, so I'm facing you, so we're gonna be doing step that you could do mirroring me. Okay, so you could do it facing me. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. So this is crossover side break. Yes. Okay. So let me make sure that you see my feet. Very important. Very important. Thank you. Yes. Can you see my feet? I need to make sure that you see that I see myself as well. This is who. This is me. Okay. How can I see myself in a big screen? Is there any way? So anyway, so you can see me better. Yes. So we do crossover side break. Crossover, side, break, and then hook, crossover. Hook, crossover, side, break. Hook, crossover, side, break. Crossover, side, break. Crossover, side, break. Hook, crossover, side, break. Hook, crossover, side, break. This is 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. Again, 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. Hook, 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. Then, from there, we're gonna go Susie Q, Susie Q. Susie Q, Susie Q. Oh, twist, step, step, from the top. Crossover, side, break, crossover, side, break. Hook, crossover, side, break. Hook, crossover, side, break. Susie Q, Susie Q, Susie Q, and Susie Q. crossover side break, crossover side break, who crossover side break, who crossover side break, Suzy Q, and Suzy Q. Okay, should we try with the music? Let's try with the music.
Ah, Rico y Mar Rivera, de Puerto Rico.
Me quisiste. Sigue tu camino, ya tú no me salas mal. Pero que sigue tu camino, ya tú no me mangas más. ¡Egua! Me quisiste. Sigue tu camino, ya tú no me salas más. Belén, sigue tu camino, que ya tú no me salas más.
So we have a capsule of three steps. Crossover side break, crossover side break, hook, crossover side break, hook, crossover side break, Suzy Q, Suzy Q. See, how was it? Yes, please don't forget, I haven't mentioned it yet, but don't forget, you have an appointment with me In August 31st at 1 o'clock Pacific time, I'm gonna be teaching a Latin fusion class for everyone around the world. So please promote it, okay? This coming Monday, August 31st, is gonna be a dance for a week. There's gonna be other teachers teaching the whole week, but it's a dance for Giovanna. Giovanna is a little kid that is battling cancer, okay? This enemy of the world, the humanity, cancer. And she's a little girl, a dancer, a future dancer, that she's in a hospital right now. Her mom is a very good friend of mine. Her name is Olivia Dasso. She's one of the LA's, Salsa LA's pioneer. And Giovanna is just 4 years old and she's battling cancer. It's a rare pediatric cancer, which is called, I believe it's rhabdomyosarcoma. Okay, so she's in a hospital and been treated by the most respected specialists around the country, but she needs our help. And I'm there and I wanted to share with the world, with my friends, because her mom is my friend, very good friend, Olivia Dasso, and she needs our help. And you know, if you can donate a little bit, you know, $1, $5, whatever you can. So please follow my Instagram. It's gonna be through my Instagram, Jhesus Aponte, J-H-E-S-U-S-A-P-O-N-T-E. And also through my Facebook page, which is Jhesus Aponte. It's easy, you find me, Jhesus Aponte, and you can find me. And so please, thank you so much. And thank you, Javier. I'm so proud of you, that all the things that you're doing. I've been doing so many things as well. You know, I gotta keep up because I can't stay still at home. I gotta keep on doing my things and creating. I cannot stay still. So, you know, I'm so blessed that I'm healthy. I've been taking vitamin C, zinc, vitamin D, multivitamin, and dancing. That feeds my soul. So thank you for having me. Thank you so much. And I hope you had a good time, and I see you soon, okay?
Right, guys, wasn't that incredible? Now we love Jhesus Aponte. Jhesus, thank you, thank you, thank you. And listen, guys, thank you so much to our guests, Christina, Carrica, Haley, Kenneth Romero, for a super successful first episode of Carrica and Romero, for using your brains, your voices, not only, you know, to create beautifulness, educate folks, entertain people, but also for creating social change, which you guys do day in and day out. And I want to say gracias for all of that. Jhesus Aponte, thank you for hanging out with us at CO3 Lounge. And I cannot wait to dance with you sooner than later. To everyone out there, make sure you fill out your 2020 census. If you don't know what your 20 census is, short definition, the census counts every person living in the United States and the five territories. So go online, stay here and watch CO3, because we will be providing information for you on the census. Guys, the census is super important. And all you have to remember is 10 by 10 by 10. 10 questions. It takes 10 minutes and it defines 10 years. All right, so 10 by 10 by 10. Census 2020. This is not the last time you're going to hear me talk about the Census 2020. And we're definitely going to be talking about that with Kenneth and Christina come the last September, Thursday of September. So again, 2020 Census, get ready to vote, get your mail-in ballots, absentee ballots, whatever you need to do, all hands on deck, mi gente. All right. So listen, besitos. I am going to say thank you so much for joining us today. I love today's show. Like, I love every single show with our wonderful guests. Okay. Gracias, gracias, gracias. We will see you next week. And make sure you stay humble, curious, and gorgeous. All right. Bye-bye, mi gente.
Perdí la cuenta, uy, he perdido.
Solivity Magazine brings you the best in inspiration on Solivity TV. Check out our new shows. Mark your calendars for Solivity Magazine shows by going to solivity.com now.